When my daughter hit 2 years old, her go-to Disney movie shifted from the adventure-filled oceans of Moana to the frigid frost of Frozen. And since then, my family hasn't been able to let it go. And with the release of Frozen 2, I don't see a break from Frozen on the horizon. But repeated reads of a book or a poem, repeated listens to an album or a song, and repeated views of a film like Frozen often allows previously unnoticed patterns to emerge, which suggest interesting themes that you hadn't seen before. When I first saw Frozen, I was impressed with the songs and the rendering of the snow, but found the story hollow. Sure, the important feminist theme seemed central to the film's impact on our culture. Elsa's rousing "Let It Go" seemed to offer women and young girls a vision of a powerful femininity, one that rejects external limitations imposed on her from family and society. And while I fully endorse the empowerment of little girls, like my daughter, to shake loose any limiting barriers to becoming their best selves, I found the film has really very little to actually say about this topic. Elsa lets go of society, her family, her responsibilities as queen. This choice not only damages her, but her sister and her kingdom. When she does the only thing she ever knew to do, isolate herself by shutting everyone out of her life, everyone's life is diminished by a symbolic and a literal winter. This was a theme worth thinking about in a children's movie, but the film's answer to Elsa's damaging isolation seemed tacked on. The love of her sister thawed her heart, opening her up to genuine human relationships again, and thus ending the symbolic and literal winter. While sweet, the movie's theme wasn't novel. It failed to say something that we wouldn't know without having experienced the film. Yes, it changed how Disney explores love from the romantic to the sibling relationship. But the theme, isolationism is harmful and family is essential, just didn't hit me. And so I was always left slightly cool on the Frozen phenomenon. But then, that all changed when a new pattern emerged from repeat viewings with my daughter. The film is just another outgrowth of a deeply Christian truth, that true, pure love is expressed through self-sacrifice. And this is the sort of love that prompts transformation and true identity. When Prince Hans leaves Anna to freeze to death, Olaf comes in, starts a fire, and gives the film's thematic explanation of love.
Love is putting someone else's needs before yours, like, you know, how Kristoff brought you back here to Hans and left you forever.
That's sacrificial love, one that emphasizes the other rather than the self. Kristoff, too, displayed this love by bringing her back to Hans, likely to lose her forever. Olaf displayed this love for Anna by standing by the fireplace, risking his life. A reading of this film's central exploration of sacrificial love is further supported by two more moments in the film. 1. Olaf's line.
Some people are worth melting for.
In this case, to melt is to die. So sacrificial love can be about giving one's life for another. And the second moment is Anna's, when she stands before Hans's blade to protect Elsa, sacrificing her life too. Suddenly, when these moments solidified into a pattern for me, the film became much richer, much more a reflection of the gospel, and thus a beautiful reflection of our intended humanness. Elsa's characterization captures our natural fear, our natural uncertainty, and our gut tendency to withdraw from others. Afraid of being feared by her community, she withdraws, creating a kingdom of isolation in the North Mountain. When Anna arrives, telling her that she doesn't have to face this alone, Elsa creates a monster to chase her sister away. And the face acting of the animators remarkably captures the nuances of regret and fear and anger in Elsa at this moment of confrontation. Despite how horribly Elsa has treated her, Anna persists in believing in her sister's ability to become something better and end the winter. Elsa does not earn or even deserve another sacrificial love, yet Anna gives it and her life. Luckily, the power of true love thawing a frozen heart saves the day, resurrecting Anna. It was sacrificial love that did the trick, not romantic or sibling or any other kind of love. This is the same love at the center of Christianity and the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, and how he and his sacrifice is meant to transform and bring new identity to the world. God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us. By this we know love, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brothers. Throughout the New Testament, Jesus refers to the kingdom of God being here, and this is how it's done, by people accepting what Christ did for us and adopting those ways in our lives, living lives of sacrificial love for others to transform this world by that love and give the world and everyone in it new identity in Christ. Now, I have to give Disney credit for one groundbreaking thing. In a movie billed as a feminist epic, the male characters are the ones that teach the female protagonists about the true meaning of love. A love that is marked by self-sacrifice. And it's ideas like this that empower men and young boys as much as women and young girls. By examining films like Frozen or Avengers Endgame, we see that our culture still values self-sacrifice as evidence of heroism and perhaps love. It's this gospel-centric value that flavors our pop culture, revealing just what kind of humans we yearn to be. And that's why culture will never let go of this film.